And now, ladies and gentlemen, we have a wonderful speaker, Mr. Vincent Anderson, and he's got quite a story, and he's quite a man. Vincent?
Thank you. Come to it. I didn't pay him for that, but I will later on. Some of you have heard this story of mine before, but it's going to be a little different this time. First of all, I want to talk about an aircraft carrier that I served on. I'll give you a brief history of that ship. It's the USS Lexington CV-2. It was commissioned on December 14, 1927 at the Bethlehem Steel Shipyards in Quincy, Massachusetts. It was immediately assigned to the Pacific Fleet, and in 1928, she made a speed run from San Pedro, California to Honolulu, setting a world record that was not broken until after World War II, averaging over 33 knots. In December of 1929 and January 1930, she supplied power to the drought-stricken city of Tacoma, Washington, for 30 days. She was known as a ship that lit up a city. And in July 1937, she made the unsuccessful search for Amelia Earhart and Fred Noonan, whose aircraft was missing on a flight from Ley, New Guinea to Howland Island in the Southwest Pacific. All during the peacetime years of the 1930s, the Lexington was a pioneer in teaching pilots, Navy pilots, the art of landing and taking off from the deck of an aircraft carrier. In addition to that, and not known by too many people, the Lexington had athletic teams that were fleet champions in baseball, basketball, and rowing. She was known as the Lady Lex, Queen of the Flat Tops. And I tell you, I'm so proud of that ship that I continue to give these talks even though I'm 90 years old and feel like 110. On February 25th, 1941, I was transferred to the Marine Detachment on the aircraft carrier Lexington. The Marines on the Lexington were the guards for the ship. They also provided orderlies for the captains and for the executive officer. Their battle stations were the 6.5-inch, 25-caliber anti-aircraft guns on the port side. Gun battery 2, port side forward with guns 2, 4, and 6. Gun battery 4, port side aft with gun batteries with guns 8, 10, and 12. When I reported aboard in February of 1941, I was assigned as a loader on gun number 6, gun battery 2, port side forward. I remained on that gun 1 year to February 42, and then I made corporal, and they transferred me aft to gun battery 4, gun 10, as the assistant gun captain and as a fuse setter. Making corporal saved my life, because on May the 8th, 1942, during the Battle of the Coral Sea, a Japanese bomb hit the flight deck of the Lexington, exploded in the ready ammunition locker of gun number 6, and killed all 14 men on that gun. I feel very fortunate in that respect. On Friday, December the 5th, 1941, Lexington left Pearl Harbor. With a squadron of Marine planes, we were taking them to Midway. On Sunday, December the 7th, 1941, we were about 200 miles off of Midway, about to launch aircraft, when we received a dispatch from Pearl. Air raid on Pearl, this is no drill. We knew then that we were at war. The Lexington throughout December of 41 and most of January of 42 patrolled the Hawaiian area. We went as far as the Marshall Islands, and we went in the area of Wake right after it had surrendered. And we were buying time for other aircraft carriers to come to the Pacific, because only the Lexington and Enterprise were in the Pacific area at the time of December the 7th. The Enterprise had left Pearl about a week before we did, and they took a squadron of Marine planes to Wake Island. Ironically, they were returning to Pearl on the morning of December the 7th. And as is customary with aircraft carriers, when you're coming into port and going to stay a couple of days, your squadrons fly off and land on the naval air stations at that port that you're at. Enterprise had sent their planes in to Pearl at about the same time that the Japanese were attacking Pearl. And so the Enterprise lost several planes due to friendly fire. At the end of January of 1942, the Lexington was sent to the Anzac area, the Solomons. Pardon me. We were to protect shipping into Australia, and where possible to do hit and run raids. On February 20th, we were near Bougainville, planning an attack on Rabaul the next morning, when we were spotted by two Japanese patrol bombers, and our fighter squadron shot down both of those Japanese scouting bombers. That was just before noon in the morning of February 20th. At about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, we came under attack by 18 Japanese two-motored horizontal bombers. They came in two waves of 9 each, about 20 minutes apart. And in the first wave, our fighters shot down all 9. And they didn't get as far as our ship to drop any bombs. But then the second wave came in, and two of our fighters went up to attack them. One of them had to peel off. We found out later his guns had jammed just before he got to them. So it left just one fighter pilot of ours attacking 9 Japanese bombers. They were coming in on the starboard side aft. I was on a 5-inch gun on the port side aft. We couldn't fire, all we could do is watch. And I can tell you, it was a very emotional time for those of us on our gun, because we saw this one pilot shoot down 5 of the Japanese bombers in about 5 minutes. Only 2 of them were got close enough to drop bombs on us. Only one Japanese bomber escaped being shot down. The pilot that shot down the 5 was Lieutenant Edward H. Butch O'Hare. He got the Congressional Medal of Honor for that action, and he became the first Navy ace of World War II. After that battle, known as the Battle of Bougainville, we met up with the carrier Yorktown, and we planned an attack on the Japanese base at Ley, New Guinea, and Salamaua, New Guinea. We pulled into the area of Port Moresby, New Guinea. Ley and Salamaua were over the mountains from us. And so our pilots had to fly over those mountains in order to get to Salamaua and Ley. 76 planes from Lexington and Yorktown made that trip. We lost one of our planes in the attack on Salamaua. The Lexington planes attacked Salamaua. The Yorktown planes attacked to delay. After that battle, the Lexington returned to Pearl Harbor. We'd been at sea for 56 days, the longest period of time since the days of steam for the Navy. We were all out of fresh water to take showers. We were taking showers with salt water. We were almost out of food. We came back into Pearl, and because we'd contacted the enemy and we had shot down some of their planes and destroyed some of their shore installations, the entire crew, including the Marine Detachment, were standing at attention on the flight deck as we entered Pearl Harbor. And I can tell you, it was one of the most emotional periods in my life, because all around Ford Island were Navy bands, and they were playing the Stars and Stripes and the national anthem and waving and cheering us as we came back, because we'd been the first to contact the enemy since the start of the war. We moored at our old mooring station on Ford Island, and the old battleship Utah that had been in front of us when we left was now upside down with nothing but the keel showing. I saw Admiral Nimitz come aboard and throw his arms around Captain Sherman, our captain of the Lexington. And we stayed in Pearl throughout April. We'd come in at about the end of March, and we stayed in Pearl throughout April, and we removed all of the 8-inch guns we had on the flight deck. The Lexington had originally been designed as a battle cruiser, and it had 8 8-inch guns on it. It was pretty obvious after Bougainville that that wasn't going to be practical. So we removed those, put 1.1s and 20 millimeters in their spot, added more guns to the 50 caliber machine guns to the stack on platforms, and got rid of all of the non-essential items that we had aboard the ship, one of which was a Hammond electric organ on the hangar deck. I think they got rid of the silver tea set that was in the officer's country too. And we got rid of most of our motor whale boats. And in the boat pockets on the ship where the motor whale boats had been, we put 20 millimeters. And on April 25th, 1942, the Lexington left Pearl to join with the Yorktown at Coral Sea. Our Navy intelligence, had determined, breaking the code of the Japanese, that the Japanese were planning to make an invasion of Port Moresby, New Guinea. Sometime in May. And so our charge was to stop that invasion. We met up with the Yorktown in the Coral Sea on May the 1st. And a couple of days later, about the second or third, two Australian cruisers showed up, the Hobart and one other. They joined us, so it truly became a allied task force. Our task force was Task Force 17. Rear Admiral Fletcher on the Yorktown was a senior officer and commander of our task force. Interesting thing about his background is that he had been awarded the Congressional Medal of Honor, the Battle of Santa Cruz, about 1902 or 3 or something like that. So he was a fighter. On the carrier Lexington, we had Rear Admiral Fitch. Fitch was a Navy pilot. So Fletcher had deferred all of our flight operations to Fitch. We were looking for the Japanese Task Force Mo, consisting of three carriers, the Shoho, the Zuikaku, and the Shokaku. And we were searching for them from about May the 3rd until the morning of May the 7th, when our morning fighter patrol found the Japanese aircraft carrier Shoho. This news came to the ship at about 9 a.m. And so immediately both Lexington and Yorktown launched their fighters, F-4F fighters, SPD dive bombers, and TBD torpedo bombers. And at about 11 o'clock in the morning, Captain Sherman on the Lexington told the radio men in the control room to turn on the loudspeakers for the ship. He wanted the men on the ship to hear our pilots as they were making their attack on the Shoho. And then suddenly we heard over the loudspeakers, "Dixon to carrier, scratch one flat top." And we knew that our pilots had just sunk the first Japanese aircraft carrier of World War II. Our planes returned, refueled, and went back out again, searching for the Shoho, or searching for the Shokaku and the Zuikaku. Did not find them. Ironically, at the time that we were sinking the Shoho, Japanese planes from the Zuikaku and the Shokaku had located our tanker, the Neosho, which is about 200 miles away from us, which we had sent away for their own protection. And with them was a destroyer by the name of Sims. Planes from the Shokaku and Zuikaku sunk the Sims, the destroyer Sims, heavily damaged the Neosho. She later was scuttled about 2 weeks later. That evening on May the 7th, we were still at general quarters on my gun because we knew the Japanese carriers were nearby. And we were bringing in our evening patrol, landing them. When we got word that there were unidentified aircraft in the landing pattern for the Yorktown, and the Yorktown was about 4 or 5 miles ahead of us. We could see the Yorktown. And come to find out, 3 Japanese planes had got into the landing pattern, obviously thinking it was their carrier. And we were told on the Lexington not to fire, because if we did, we'd be firing at the Yorktown. And just as those planes got pretty close to the Yorktown, they suddenly realized that this wasn't their carrier, and they peeled off. And boy, all of our cruisers and destroyers let fire at them. They shot down 2, but 1 got away. And then we could see them going down at the horizon and lights on the horizon. We were that close to the Japanese carriers and didn't realize it. That night, we were in condition 2 on my gun. That meant half the gun crew was on duty. The other half was off for 4 hours. We changed every 4 hours. I can remember vividly going up to the flight deck at around midnight when I was relieved and laying down and just looking at the sky and seeing the Southern Cross. A beautiful sight. The weather was nice, it was clear, and the seas were calm. In the Navy, they have the saying, fair winds and following seas. That was what it was like on the night of May the 7th. On the morning of May the 8th, just at dawn, we went back into general quarters, all men manning the guns, and we launched our morning patrol. And about 9 a.m., we got word that they had found the Shokaku and the Zuikaku. And so we, the Lexington and the Yorktown, both launched our attack aircraft, and they took off. And about 11 a.m., radar picked up a large number of Japanese planes headed our way, about 58 miles away. There were approximately 70 Japanese planes, dive bombers, torpedo bombers. At about 11:15 in the morning, we saw the first Japanese torpedo plane off of our port bow at about 3,000 yards out, and we started firing. And the ship picked up speed. We were making evasive actions to avoid torpedoes. The torpedo bombers were coming at us on both sides of the ship, and they were strafing our gun batteries as they came close by. We suddenly felt a tremendous explosion, and we'd been hit by a torpedo, port side forward, right near our gun 2 battery. And then within a couple of more minutes, we took a second hit, torpedo hit, just behind the first one. And about that time, the dive bombers were coming down on us and dropping bombs on us. We were zigzagging all over the place. And one bomb hit the flight deck, exploded in the ready ammunition locker, gun number 6, and killed all 14 men on the gun. Another bomb hit our stack and wiped out about 3 of our 50 caliber machine gun groups. Also, what it did was sever the siren cord. And so the ship's siren cord was now going, or the ship's siren was now going off with all this ammunition being fired. And it was mind-boggling. And then a bomb just about hit our gun 10 battery, sent up a wave of water about 70, 80 feet high, washed all of us off of my gun. And if it hadn't been for the splinter shields on the perimeter, we would have been washed over the side. That attack by the Japanese only lasted about 15 minutes. I swear it felt like 4 hours because we were just constantly firing. After the Japanese had left, we were in a list 7 degrees to the port. We were making 25 knots, and damage control got us on an even keel within an hour. On my gun battery, we were taking care of the wounded and the killed. Three of my men on my gun were injured, seriously injured. One was killed. The one that was killed was a private by the name of Raymond Miller. He was later awarded the Navy Cross for continuing to load ammunition while he was mortally injured and dropped dead. Later found out that his name was not Raymond Miller. It was another name. He had enlisted by getting somebody to sign for his parents. He was only 17 years old. One of my rear best friends, T.D. Germany, was on gun 8. And I saw him lying on the deck with a corpsman working over him. And I bent down and asked the corpsman how bad he was, and the corpsman just shook his head. So I said to T.D., "Can you hear me?" And he said, "Yes." I said, "We're going to make damn sure to get you off this ship, and you're going to get taken care of." He said, "I'll never make it. I'm going to die. You better take your pipe." I'd loaned him a yellow bow pipe to break in for me. I was reluctant, but he insisted, and so I took it and put it in my pocket. I saw him later take TD and put him on the flight deck and cover him over with a tarp with the rest of those that had been killed that were easily able to get, they were easily able to get hold of. Our planes returned from attacking the Zuikaku and Shokaku, and we refueled and launched them on another attack. Didn't find out until later that on the first attack they were able to heavily damage the Shokaku, but couldn't find the Zuikaku because it was in a cloud cover. In any event, about 12:30 in the early afternoon, there was a horrendous explosion inside the ship. Found out later that the Japanese torpedoes hits had ruptured the high-octane gasoline lines that we used to fuel our aircraft. And apparently a spark from a motor in the machine shop area ignited these fumes and caused the explosion. We fought the fires for about 4 hours. We were able to receive our returning aircraft and till about 2:30 in the afternoon. By that time, the fires had spread throughout the entire ship below decks. Men were trapped in compartments. Some I talked to later escaped by crawling through vent shafts. In any event, At about 5 o'clock in the afternoon, Captain Sherman gave the order to abandon ship. It was understood that the Marines would continue to man Gun Battery 4 until all divisions had abandoned. At about 5:35 in the afternoon, Captain Sherman came down to our gun battery and ordered us to abandon ship. Our First Sergeant Payton then said, "Men, let's give 3 cheers to the captain." And we did. Captain Sherman later wrote in his book, Combat Command, "Their loyalty was inspiring." Well, I had looked out to see who was picking up survivors. Some destroyers had come in on the starboard side, and the wounded men were being lowered into those ships. I was an excellent swimmer in those days, and I had spotted a life raft out about 400 yards, and I knew I could make it. So I tried to talk some of my Marine buddies into going with me, and none of them thought they could make it that far. I didn't want to stay around the ship anymore because it was exploding, and fires were great. I got to tell you, before I had abandoned ship, I had gone up on the flight deck, and I found one of our men from Gun Battery 2 with a corpsman walking alongside of him, stark naked. All of his clothes had been burned off. His skin was hanging down from his hands. And he said to me, "Andy, you got a cigarette?" He'd been pumped so full of morphine, he didn't know what he was doing. He died within minutes. In any event, the crew of the Lexington had thrown knotted ropes over the side so the men could lower themselves down into the water. But before many of them had done that, a friend of mine found a fire axe and took it to the ship store and knocked down the door to the ship store and liberated all the ice cream. Guys were walking around with helmets full of ice cream before they abandoned ship. Nobody was in a real hurry. Those that were abandoning were taking their shoes off and lining them up on the flight deck. In any event, I gave my life jacket away because I didn't want to be hindered in my swim. I cut off the sleeves of my shirt. I cut off my slacks just above the knee, and I put my shoes back on the flight deck with the rest of them. And then I lowered myself down, and it was like going out a 7-story window into the water. It was warm, gentle swells. I didn't realize at the time that it was the most shark-infested waters in the world. In any event, I started my swim, and suddenly I realized that at times I couldn't see that life raft. I was in the bottom of a swell. It was only when I'd get on the top of the swell I could see the life raft. And then for a while I thought that life raft was drifting further away than I was able to swim. However, I eventually got to the life raft. It was a 20-man life raft, had no provisions in it, no means of propulsion, and I crawled into that life raft all alone, and I looked back at the Lexington, and it was blowing up, and pieces of the ship as big as a barn door were flying over my head. In a short time, I picked up a pilot in a Mae West and pulled him into the life raft. And then the two of us picked up about three sailors and pulled them in. And we were looking around to see who was going to get us, and we couldn't see anybody. No ships. And then suddenly around the stern of the Lexington came this gig boat from the destroyer Anderson. But it was chock full of survivors. There wasn't room for anybody else in it. But the coxswain wanted to let us know that he knew that we were there and needed to be picked up. And so he came close by and said, "I'll be back to get you." And one of the guys in the raft, I don't know who it was, said, "Haven't you got a rope you can give us and we can tie on and you can tow us?" And he looked and he found a rope and he threw it. And we tied the rope on. But whoever tied it on the gig boat left a long tail. And it got tangled in the screw of the gig boat. And that killed the motor to the gig boat and it went dead in the water. Well, the coxswain went over a couple of times to try and cut it loose. It was unsuccessful. And so we were just sitting there, gig boat full of survivors and us in the life raft. And then we see in the distance coming over the horizon a destroyer. And the destroyer is headed right for us. And as it gets real close, the captain of the destroyer had a big megaphone. And he hollered at us. And he said, "I can't stop Japanese subs in the area. I'll make a circle, grab the cargo nets." And he did, and we did. And I got pulled aboard that destroyer, the Dewey. Somebody on the Dewey would take each survivor by hand and take them to their quarters. A little short guy by the name of Hussey, machinist mate first class, got hold of me. He started taking me forward, all the rest of them going aft. I said, "Where are you taking me?" And he said, "I'm taking you to the wardroom, sir." I said, "I'm not a officer." He says, "What the hell are you?" I says, "I'm a corporal in the Marine Corps." He says, "Oh, gee, I pull a lousy Marine out of the water." In any event, he takes me down to his quarters. He's about 5'8", I'm 6'2", and he gives me a pair of trousers and a shirt and some moccasins. The only thing that fit, we were both waist size the same, both 32-inch waist. I only weighed 148 pounds in those days. Well, he said, "You better take a shower first." And I took a shower, and I'm just getting out of the shower when general quarters sounded. And boy, aboard ship, when general quarters sounds, they latch down all the hatches, and they're not open until after general quarters is secured. So I couldn't get out. I'm trapped down below. And I made a solemn promise to myself, if I ever get out of this hole and get topside, I'm never going below decks again. And I didn't. We got, it took us about 3 days to get to Noumea, New Caledonia. The Dewey had picked up 122 survivors from the Lexington, almost as many as their crew on their ship. We got to Noumea, New Caledonia, and they wouldn't let us go ashore. Vichy French and Free French were still fighting each other. But I got transferred to the cruiser Astoria. And when I got on the Astoria, I I saw a Marine from the Marine Detachment on the Astoria. I said, are there any Lexington Marines on board? And he says, we got two down in sick bay. So I went down to sick bay to see who they were, and I stepped through the hatch into sick bay, and suddenly I heard, you son of a bitch, you stole my pipe. And it was T.D. Germany sitting up in a bunk with a cast around his body. And what had happened, apparently, a couple of sailors had, as they were leaving the ship on the flight deck, saw his hand move. So they checked him out and saw he was actually alive. And so they lowered him down into a destroyer that took him to Noumea, New Caledonia, and transferred him to the Astoria. Well, it was a pleasure to see him. I tried to give him the pipe, even though it was mine, and he wouldn't take it because he said the doc wouldn't let him smoke anyway. We left that night for Tonga Tabu, and we got to Tonga. There were two troop ships waiting. They'd brought an army division out, the Barnett and the Elliott, and a hospital ship, the Solis. All of our injured were transferred to the Solis. I was transferred to the Elliott, George F. Elliott, which was later sunk that year in the Guadalcanal campaign. We left Tonga Tabu about 2 days later. The Yorktown had suffered one bomb hit in the Battle of the Coral Sea, but was essentially in good condition. And Nimitz wanted the Yorktown back to Pearl as quick as possible because the Battle of Midway was coming up. And so the Yorktown, with almost all of the Task Force 17 ships, we had seven cruisers and 14 destroyers. They all went to Pearl, and Yorktown was able to get fixed up well enough to make the Battle of Midway 3 weeks later. We on the Elliott and Barnett were escorted partway by the cruiser Chester. Then they left us in a hurry because they had Admiral Fitch on board, and he was designated to be the admiral on the Saratoga, which was in Long Beach at the time, and they wanted him on board the Saratoga for the Battle of Midway. We got into San Diego Harbor on June the 2nd, 1942. Arrived late in the afternoon. We were all told on both troop ships to stay below decks. They did not want anybody in San Diego or anywhere else in the United States to know that survivors from the Lexington were arriving. Nobody had been told yet that the Lexington had been lost. They didn't want the Japanese to know that the battle was just starting. In fact, the Battle of Midway started the day that we arrived in San Diego. And we marched ashore at around 10 o'clock at night, and they had barracks for us at the San Diego destroyer base. And then for the next 2 weeks, they were reconstructing our records and getting us new uniforms. A good buddy of mine, a ship's cook, first class by the name of Swafford, told me that he had escaped the Lexington with $1,000 war bond, and that he was going to head to the first Bank of America he could find and cash it in, and did I want to go with him? And I said, sure. We'd been ashore, I think, about 2 days when we got a pass for about 8 hours, 8 in the morning to about 4 in the afternoon. We were still in the clothes that had been given to us, not in any uniform. And so I'm in dungarees and a pair of moccasin slippers. And Roy and I caught the first bus we could catch outside the gate. We were given a paper pass for the period of time. And all it referred to us as gave our name, our serial number, and our rank, and that we were from the Minutemen unit at the destroyer base. Well, as soon as Roy and I got off the bus in downtown San Diego, we hadn't walked 40 feet before the shore patrol picked us up. And they wanted to know if we were in the military. We said, yep. They said, you're out of uniform. We said, yeah. And we showed them our one-day pass. That didn't satisfy them. In the paddy wagon. So we got in the paddy wagon. They took us to the shore patrol office, and the duty officer looked at our passes, and he called the officer of the day at the destroyer base, gave him our names, and we couldn't understand the conversation between them, but all we knew that after a few minutes, he hung up the phone and he turned to the shore patrol guys that had picked us up and said, I don't know where these guys have been or what they've done. Don't bother them. No more. Take them back to where they were. And we did, and they did. And Roy crossed in that $1,000 war bond, got $750. And for the next 2 weeks at Sherman's Dine and Dance, one of the better dens of iniquity in San Diego, we celebrated. Now, a little epilogue for the Battle of the Coral Sea. It was the first Navy battle in history in which the ships on either side never saw each other, never fired a shot at each other. It stopped the Japanese invasion of Port Moresby, saved Australia's northern coast. And I'd like to read to you what the noted naval historian Samuel Eliot Morrison wrote of the Coral Sea Battle in his History of the United States Naval Operations in World War II. The morale value of the battle to all Allied nations, coming as it did immediately after the surrender of Corregidor, was immeasurable. Captain Sherman's statement, articles by shipboard correspondents, and numerous interviews with survivors printed in their hometown papers told a story of cool efficiency, relentless action, superb heroism, and determination. That story of the last fight of the Lady Lex, her calm abandonment, the devotion of her crew to their ship and their captain transcended mere history. The American people took it to their hearts and stored it up in the treasury of folk history. Now, I also want to tell you, the Australian government has on numerous occasions invited me to return, and I have returned for the 50th anniversary and the 60th anniversary of the Battle of the Coral Sea. I was treated like a hero. When I got there, the governor of Queensland had my wife and I in for morning tea at the governor's mansion, and pictures of me and other survivors were in the Australian papers, captured saviors of a nation. In 1968, Neil Morgan, a columnist for the San Diego Evening Tribune, was attending a Coral Sea Battles commemorative program in Sydney, Australia. And I'd like to read to you what he had to say. "I was nowhere near the Coral Sea 26 years ago when some heroic remnants of the US fleet held off the Japanese Navy and saved Australia's north coast from occupation. But tonight, when I dropped by the annual Coral Sea Ball here, the Aussies made me feel like a bloody hero just because I'm a Yank. Someone may correct me, but I can think of no other nation that stages an annual celebration of a foreign military victory. Most Americans cannot tell you that May 7th is the anniversary of the first great US Navy victory of World War II, but the Australians can. There was nothing else in 1942 but a few Yanks between their continent and the Japanese fleet. So the Battle of the Coral Sea is commemorated each year in Australia, and the Australian-American Society sponsors one of the more elegant affairs of the season. Toasts are given to a bond of mutual trust that stems more and more rare in the international affairs. Thank you for listening to my talk."